you've covered long conflicts during your stay with the Times. You were in Belfast during the Northern Ireland Troubles. You've been to Middle East for a very long time. You were in Russia in the years of Perestroika. Suddenly, in December 1989, you were dispatched to cover the short but violent Romanian Revolution. Somehow, it happened to be you from all time reporters, as you recall in a recent blog post. What were your expectations on your way here as a journalist covering world hotspots?
Well, you know, like often when you go as what we call in the profession a farman, it's different than when you know a place, then you're resident, you know. But a farman goes in and put out the fire. And I didn't know anything, but I expected from what I'd seen that it might be quite, tough, because one of our previous correspondent had been shot. Not badly, I'm glad to say, but he had been. A number of international journalists have had enormous problems getting across the border from Timisoara from Hungary. I was on a plane, one of the first planes to land at the airport, which was, it looked a bit like the set of a movie. In that they weren't shooting, I'm very glad to say. Well, the plane wouldn't have landed otherwise, but they had been. So there were lots of broken windows, bullet holes, and that sort of thing. But it was working. And being Romania, there was a taxi driver who, for quite a few green dollars, was prepared to go into the centre of Bucharest. And that's what, I mean, journalists usually, it's a bit of a cliche, but journalists rely on taxi drivers. I mean, you don't take a Hertz car in the middle of a revolution. So I didn't really know what to expect, but, it may sound to an outsider frightening, but I can assure you journalists aren't really, with a few exceptions, great heroes. And what they rely on to, keep them sane is their colleagues, men and women from not only from Britain, but from covering the Romanian Revolution from virtually every country in the world. Once one got into town, human being a human, find a bed. Well, it wasn't difficult to find a bed because by then the press corps, don't forget this was a few days after the real shooting had started. The only shooting left when I arrived was the Securitate snipers were in the sewers.
So when exactly have you arrived here?
I can't frankly remember the exact date, but about late December, maybe 1st January, when the only real armed resistance left was the Securitate snipers on the roofs and in the sewers. And nobody knew about this. There were lots of myths about this underground city that Ceausescu had built. But anyway, that was... Then they started to form the National Committee.
Given the second tier of communist politicians and Securitate officers rose to power in December 1989, there has been a long debate in Romania. Was it a real revolution? Was it a stolen popular revolt? Was it a coup d'etat? 25 years on, what is your view about this revolution? And
my view coming, I had been to Romania before, because I was based in Moscow, and I'd come with the Kremlin, with the foreign press corps from Moscow, when Mr. Gorbachev came. And Mr. Gorbachev couldn't stand Mr. Ceausescu. He regarded him as a sort of Stalin-type figure. My view, but it's frankly not based on enormous amount of hard evidence, because this debate will never end, because it's too late to prove it. But my view is there was certainly Russian inspiration behind a Romanian base. And the only reason I have to add a little meat to that fairly provocative, though widely held sort of conspiracy theory, is that I knew how much the Russians disliked Ceausescu.
They want to get rid of him?
Him, definitely, but not necessarily the system.
Yeah.
I mean, don't forget, you know, Russia, Mother Russia.
Yeah.
Gorbachev never wanted to get rid of communism.
Okay.
He wanted to reform it and have glasnost and perestroika and make communism sellable. To the people. But what happened was there was apparently Russian writing in the guest book of the Athenae Palace, and that that page had been torn out. But one journalist used his common sense and used a pencil to trace the signatures underneath, which you can do, and they were Russian. So there is a theory, and I stress it's only a theory, that there were some Russians in that square who helped the booing.
Yeah,
because without somebody to lead it, why hadn't there been a revolution before?
Yeah. But the movement was there, you say?
Yes, they didn't fly in 500 KGB men with funny hats on. But they, you know, the KGB is a very, very clever organization, and it can
manipulate.
Well, it's called another name now, FSN, isn't it? But same man, different hat. But they helped, I think they helped it, but that's my view.
Yeah.
And I know there are speakers tonight who take a different view.
Yeah. How do you find Bucharest and Romania 25 years after the
Well, I'm. I'm glad to see it's looking, you know, not totally prosperous, but in good shape. And it's managing to stay in good shape, I think, because it maintains an old feeling, along with the modernity of the buildings. Reminds me of Dublin, which is a city I've always been very affectionate of. I mean, you don't see, frankly, there's more... I know there's a lot of controversy about Romanians. We won't go into that. Romanians in London taking my job and all that business. But there are certainly more beggars in London than
because
there are here.
Romanian beggars.
And they're not Romanian beggars. They're all sorts of beggars. Yes. And there are plenty of poverty in London as well. But I would say here that, you know, what do you instantly get the feel of? You know, everybody's got a mobile phone. All the women look like executives.
Yeah.
I imagine them all sort of, you know, having management meetings and such like. There's a lot of that sort of middle-ranking power, commercial power. But I would say that still slightly a feeling of the past. I mean, what's amazing, actually, if you want a frank view, that it's nothing to do with Ceausescu, is to an English member of the European Union, like myself, to find smoking in public is almost as though the whole people in the bar of the Intercontinental were nude, because we don't see smoking.
Okay.
We haven't seen it for years. And the fact it's taking place without anybody protesting, caring, writing in the paper that the whole of Romania is going to die of lung cancer, it's extraordinary. So in a way, it's not an enormous truth, but it shows you that this is a different society. It run in a different way. And it's choosing, it's a member of the EU.
Yeah.
It's not a member of the euro, which is why the currency works.
Yeah.
I'd still say it feels a bit cut off from the world. There are not enough international newspapers and news. I mean, I was quite amazed in the Intercontinental, which is still one of the leading hotels in the area, as well as the city. I mean, I said to the receptionist, where in the hotel do I get an English newspaper?
Yeah.
I was thinking of the International Herald, well, what's now the New York Times International, actually. And they said, oh, no, they're only Romanian. And I said, well, there must be somewhere out. Well, there may be somewhere outside. I don't know. So there still is a cut-off feeling.
Maybe on the internet?
There is the internet. People do find the internet, but I would say still people don't talk terrifically about world affairs in the way that they do in other European countries. They're not always debating Merkel, and they're quite insular. And of course, a revolution anniversary makes you insular, but they're looking back.
Yeah.
And they don't seem to totally be sure who the heroes are. Usually when you've had a revolution, you have a hero, like Che Guevara, or even Lenin, or... But here, they don't know whether Mr. Ion Ionescu is a hero, or Mr. Petri Roman is a hero, or is he a crooner from a boat who looks good?
What do you think?
I tend to think Mr. Ionescu is a very clever man and an extremely likable man. I've met him for over an hour and a half today. And personally, I find him very charming and knowledgeable. And I think it's a pity he's not more at the center of affairs. At his age, he's remarkably literate and, you know, agile mentally.
Yeah. Okay. But you mentioned the influence of Moscow here in 25 years ago. But what about the Western influence? Do you recall any?
Not much. I can't recall any. I thought the British were a rather ineffectual embassy here. It was a bit of a backwater. I think now it's more important to the West, because it's one of the few members of the EU that's pro-Western. They're mostly looking towards, on this part of the world, I mean. I don't mean Estonia, or something, but no, and the American, people ask me about the Americans. I mean, to be quite honestly, I can't remember any. I can remember American journalists, but not, I can't remember CIA men walking around with cigars saying, "Hey, bud," you know, no.
So, do you think the Russians?
I think the Russians.
The only
game in town.
Who,
yes.
Who
yes.
One Romanian journalist blogger recently discovered a piece of news from Romanian media in early 1990, which quoted a report in the Times that even the weather journal used to be fixed by the communist regime.
Yes.
Do you remember? Do you recall?
I'd recall that.
Your piece, for example, was...
Could well have been. They certainly did it in Moscow. Every time there was a parade on May Day, and if it was looking bad weather, they sent up the planes and they could fight, they could de-seed the clouds. So, I mean, when it says making the weather, that's journalese. But fixing the weather for a big event, yes, absolutely. And the same in, I mean, for instance, I happen to know for a fact that in Egypt, where over a certain, which is the opposite way, where over a certain temperature, factories should send home their workers and schools should close, that the government used to order the fact that the temperature never went over that age, because it didn't. I mean, it did, but nobody was told. They were told it stopped at 41, not that it was really 45.
If you were to look for historical hints in Romania's current situation as a NATO member, neighboring a growingly hostile Russia, where would you look for hints?
What do you mean? Sorry, I didn't quite understand the question.
Current situation of Romania, neighboring Russia, growingly hostile Russia. Okay, for what kind of hints would you look as a journalist right now? Regarding the political situation in Romania, neighboring Russia?
I think there's a hope, you know, that it's elected a president with an independent mind and German background.
Okay.
That's going to help enormously with their European contacts. I think, like all countries close to the Soviet, well, what was the Soviet Union, there's going to be trouble, because Mr. Putin doesn't like countries geographically placed in what he calls our near abroad, being under the influence of either the European Union, but especially NATO. And that is, we can go through the list, starting with Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia, Poland, and I think Romania is the southern end of that particular line, with particular interest because it has access to the sea, which is a very useful point. Russia has always been paranoid about not having its own access to the sea.
Yeah.
Are we getting close to that?
1 minute.
Yes.
Okay. If your short account about the revolution on the UK ambassador's blog recently, you write over terrible images, the memory of the revolutionary dead, the stench of the orphanages, the AIDS issue, the minister, the miners,
AIDS issue, yes,
the miners at the Intercontinental, such stories, especially the ones about abandoned children and poverty, were everywhere in Western media regarding Romania. How did you, as an individual journalist and as a member of the Foreign Press Corps, get these stories? How did you manage to get these stories and put...
Well, it was an enormous story, particularly the orphanages, and I think the power, not only of the press, but the media, and not only the British, is the number of charities that have grown up with a particular eye to looking after Romanian orphans. I personally found it absolutely shocking. I've been in many war zones, but I can tell you the wards, when we discovered them, not me personally, but a number of journalists, we had a photographer from the Times who was sick. The smell, the kids were chained to the side of their metal beds. And when it materialized that this lunatic had injected people with contaminated blood under the impression that this was going to improve their health, I mean, you really were in cloud cuckoo land. And don't forget that every country has its myths and its ogres and its icons. And Romania, whatever it does, can't get rid of Dracula. He's there. Just like Scotland will never get rid of Braveheart. And Ireland will never get rid of, their IRA gunmen. They're there. They may not be fighting and he may not be existing, but blood, needles, death, horrible man with an awful face. But it wasn't Romania that got the bad reputation. I mean, Romania had taken a revolution to get rid of this madman. So, I mean, it was him. And I think particularly that was Gorbachev's point of view, because we were briefed, the foreign press were briefed by Moscow, not necessarily in public. I mean, they cooperated with us to an extent to tell us what. They usually told the Yugoslavs. The Yugoslavs then told us, intentionally, that really Gorbachev just hated Ceausescu. He thought he was bad for a human. His wife hated him, and he was very much in love with Raisa. She loathed him and loathed Elena.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's it.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.